Welcome and good afternoon. I'm Anwarullah Bhuiyan from Bangladesh. I'm a professor of philosophy in Jahangir Nobel University. So,
can I jump in?
I'll give lectures on two aspects. The first one is cultural realisms of Bangladesh, and the second one is bioethical explorations or bioethical practices in Bangladesh. I think culture and realism is very important factor for doing bioethics. So now culture and realism is different or related to every nations, ethnicity, and to the attitude of the peoples. Suppose the culture of Japan and the culture of Bangladesh are not similar because of their behind their lot of things are existed. Even when I was first meet with Sarkar at the cafeteria this morning, first I asked her, "Are you from India?" Without any hesitations, it was possible to ask her, "Are you from India?" I'm also Indian, don't worry. Right now I'm living in Bangladesh, but once that was a part of India. Actually, her places and my place is not so different from the cultural, linguistics, and lot of things are common there. So I think culture is very important factor to take decisions. When we are taking bioethical decisions, we must consider the culture and religions of the people. Suppose if any persons who believes in Jehovah beliefs, Jehovah conventions, they have some sort of practices, they have some sort of beliefs, and they have some sort of values regarding many things. But the people of Muslim are not follow the same principles and norms as the other people like Hindus or Christian or Jews or follows. So I think culture is very important factor to identify other people's norms and values. So that I'm interested to talk about the cultures of Bangladesh. So you can see this is Bangladesh, and this is the map of Asia. This is the place of Bangladesh here. So that is the geographical exposition of Bangladesh. And so that's the land of Bangladesh. And this is Bay of Bengal. So this big country emerged as independent and sovereign country in 1971. And the official name of this country is the People's Republic of Bangladesh. And the state language is Bangla. Amra Banglai kotha boli. Most of the people speak in Bangla. However, English is widely spoken, but not much dominating language. Most of the people can speak English. How are you? I am fine. That's good, like that. And our nationality is Bangladesh. So that's a very important question. What is religion? And what is bioethics? And what is the relationship between culture, religion, and bioethics? As you know, bioethical principles and practice influenced by different cultural background. Applications of westernized bioethical principles in cultural settings vary more often from one cultural perspective to the other because of the different understanding and perspectives of what are values and good. If I ask you what is your values, you must answer to these questions on the basis of your ethnicity and on the basis of your religious point of view. So most of the exponents of global bioethics argue that this principle should be universally acceptable, but is it possible regarding the existing cultural diversities? For example, David Mesa also believed that the UNESCO, they have some declarations on the perspective of human rights and dignity of human rights and genome related issues. There are some principles launched by United Nations or UNESCO. UNESCO, it is quite impossible to follow the every culture equally. They just simply ask to follow some conventions. For example, informed consent, the dignity of human beings, the confidentiality, the autonomy of persons, and the freedom of human decisions making capacity. Like these things, vulnerability, like these things should be considered when a person's or state taking any sort of decisions regarding bioethical problems. So, the every state or every country has his own rights to take the decisions on the basis of their culture and religion. For example, a Muslim country like Bangladesh, Pakistan, Afghanistan, or Iran, they will take some particular sort of decisions regarding abortion. But the European people will not take the same decisions regarding abortion. They have some different sort of expositions. Most of the cases, the European people will consider the right life savings conditions will be get more priority in the context of Europe. But in the Muslim country, the life conditions, whatever the life conditions or life status, that should not be considered. The considering issue should be the religious conviction, the religious principles or norms. For example, in Islam, there is a strict and very hard rule not to abort in any cases. There are also two sort of explanations regarding abortions in Islam. Some people say there is a liberal exposition, and there are also some orthodox expositions. Most of the cases, orthodox expositions are very much welcome for the people of Muslim. Orthodox exposition that reflect not to abort, whether the case of mother's life savings issue, not to abort. That's the main central point of abortions regarding the belief of Muslim peoples or Islam. So, on the other hand, if you see the people of Europe, they will not follow seriously or strictly any sort of religious norms or beliefs. They'll see the matter from the secular perspective. First of all, they'll see whether the mother's life is on risk. In that case, they'll take the decisions, yes, abortion can be allowed or abortion can be permitted. Such and such conditions, abortion should be permitted in Europe. So I want to say, the same things are treated differently in the different cultures. The cases like abortion, there are many things are there we can give here as an example, but we see the point. Is it possible regarding the existing cultural diversity? I'm talking about the global bioethics. Is it possible to practice global bioethics? The question the answer to this question would be a bit, skeptic, or there is some confusion to answer to these questions whether global bioethics is possible or not. For example, the Japanese people, they have some particular sort of bioethics, and the Indian people, they have some particular sort of bioethics. And every bioethics, they develop on their own culture and religious belief. This is the main point here. So, this is a question, how can we understand the term culture? So what is culture? What is the meaning of culture? How can we understand the term culture? Actually, culture is an integrated pattern of knowledge, values, belief, rules, attitudes, and behaviors shared by the members of a society and community. There are many things, as we found here. Culture is related to people's knowledge pattern, their values, their beliefs, rules, attitudes, and behavior pattern. All these things are there as a component of culture. So culture includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, laws, customs, and habits that is acquired by man as a member of a society. So how can we understand the term values and norms? I want to say values and norms, that is a content component of a culture. That's a very serious component of a culture. Values, that means abstract ideas about the good and the right and the desirable somethings. Desirable somethings, desirable, that may be good or bad desire, but that should be mean as a term, values. There are another part, that is norms. Norms, that is the social rules, guide appropriate behavior for specific situations. Customs, that is another term for norms. I think values, norms, and customs, these three things are reflecting a same meaning or same significance. Customs, values, and norms. Okay? And another, there is another component of a culture, that is language, cognitive capacity, and these things are the component of culture. So, if you see, that is religion. How can we understand the term religion? Religion, that is the practices. Religion, that is the belief. Religion, that may be sacred something. Religion, that may be ritual. So, there are many religions, they have some particular sort of belief. For example, Buddhist belief, Jainist belief, Hindu belief, Muslim belief, or Christianity. This one kind of belief. The Muslim people will not follow the values of Christian people, and the Christian people will not follow the values of Hindus people. Every people's values and belief are different from their own perspective. So religion, that is some segment or components. These are the components of religions. So how can we define the term religion? Religion is a social institutions involving beliefs and practices based upon the conceptions of the sacred, holy something. The verse is come from outside of the world, from outer world, God and the God sent persons like prophet or holy personality has brought the book like Quran, Bible, Gita, all these sorts of things. So, we can make a difference between culture and religion. I want to say, culture is a broad conception. Religion is a segmental conception. So, if you see these two diagram, you can find religion as a component of culture. Okay? There are many, many, many components of culture. Society itself is the basis of a culture, and there are also ethical values, traditions, science, technology, philosophy, art and literature, politics. All these are the component of a society, and the society is very much involved with the cultural background. Every society developed on their own culture. But you see, religion itself is a component of a culture. So there is a difference between culture and religion. We never should puzzle to define culture as a religion or religion as a culture. That's a completely different things. Culture, that's a broad sense, and religion, that is a segment or components of a culture. Okay, what is the nature of a culture of Bangladesh? As I know, there are two sort of culture, there are two stream of culture in Bangladesh. The strong stream, this is the strong stream can found in Bangladesh, Muslim culture or Muslim religious belief and Hindu religious belief, and the weak stream, that is Buddhist and Christian. Christian is a very few number of peoples we can found in Bangladesh, but Buddhist, I think, 1 point something or like 2% peoples are Buddhist, and 8 to 10% peoples are Hindu, and the rest of the peoples are Muslim. So that can be allocated by this way: Muslim 85%, Christian 0.4%, Buddhist 0.1%, sorry, Hindu and other together 14.5%. That is the religious distributions of in Bangladesh. Okay, so how the culture actually, I want to say previously we say that religion and culture is differently, seriously different, and we should not identify culture as a religion or religion as a culture. But I want to emphasize on culture. Culture in Bangladesh, there are two sort of controversy or disputations to define culture in regarding Bangladesh. There's one disputation that is inclusionary, and there is another one is separatism. Separatism, that means, from the very beginning of my lectures, I want to say you, Bangladesh, that's a part of India. Once that was a part of India. Right now, that's a Muslim dominating country. But once, most of the peoples were either Hindus or Buddha. But after 800 AD, the Muslim invasions had occurred in Bangladesh, and they migrated the people, they converted the people into Muslim cultures and values. And so here the people are not seriously follow the norms and values of good Islam. If you go through all the countries, then you can find the Muslim peoples, they are also follow some sort of Hindu religious conventions. And if you just analysis the marital system in Bangladesh, you find the Muslim conventions, at the same time you can find the Hindu conventions are present there. Suppose there are some systems of marriage of Hindu conventions, but most of the conventions are present in the Muslim marital systems. But the difference is there on regarding the religious values. One is saying some surah or some verses from Quran, recited from the Quran by a Muslim scholar or Molana, and they come to the house and they uttered some surah from the Quran and the people getting together. That is the primary marital convention of Muslim peoples, Muslim people's marital systems. But in addition, there are some more extra things that are present in the marital system of Banashi peoples. As we found these things in the Hindu marital systems. I want to say, most of the peoples are Muslim, but they are not seriously follow the convention and norms of Islam. They are influenced by other religions like Buddhism and Hinduism. So I want to say that Islam in Bangladesh or the Muslim peoples and the beliefs in Bangladesh are not seriously separated from other religions of India like Hinduism and Buddhism. But some peoples or exponents want to say Islam is a completely different and they have some particular values and norms, and these very norms are followed by the people of Bangladesh. That's one kind of controversy, that's one kind of belief among the Muslim scholar. But I think our Islam is very much, it develops on the basis of syncretization. That's a syncretized within the different religions and customs. And there we can find the Hindu customs, we found there the Buddhist customs, and also found some ethnic cultural values. So Islam in India or Islam in Bangladesh is not completely an Arabian Islam or African Islam. That's a different sort of Islam we can find in India and even in Bangladesh. So our Islam or our Muslim peoples and their culture and convention is completely different from the other Muslim peoples and Islamic believers peoples. So, there's a question, why the peoples of Bangladesh are followed the different cultures and different religions and different conventions? That's a very significant questions to understand the people of Bangladesh. I think the people of Bangladesh, they have a different religions, they have a different food habit systems, they have a different languages, and they have a different social habits and characteristics. These things has made their mind to follow the diverse cultural background. And our lands scape is very diverse, and the landscape is very, very much interesting. Somewhere there is a level landscape, and there are also sea, and there are also river, and there are also some hill tracts. So peoples, regarding their geographical expositions, are making their cultural values and norms. So nature, I want to say, nature influence to create the values and norms of the people. So our nature is very much diverse, and nature is very much, I want to say, there is a diversity of our landscape, there is a diversity of our cultural background. So Bangladeshi mind, Bangladeshi people's mind incorporates this mutual understanding of diverse cultural religions and also the diversity of their natural background. So the persistence of diverse influences of in Indian mindset or Bangladeshi people's mindset has shaped the thinking and attitude of the Bangladeshi people. So our core ideas and values of Bangladeshi peoples are mutual, that has built up, that has developed under the conceptions of mutual relationship, and the form of our culture is synthetical. Synthetical, I mean, our cultures of a community shape its inhabitants' behavior, their belief, and their religions and customs are developing with the other peoples, with a different sort of culture, different sort of religions, and different sort of belief. So, Okay. So how can we understand the culture of Bangladesh people? Actually, the Bengal region has a multifaceted folk heritage. We have a multifaceted folk heritage enriched by its ancient enemies, Jaino, Buddhist, Hindu and Muslim roots. Folk theater like Jatra, folk song like Palagan, common at the village level and usually take places during harvest time or at meals, that's the village fair. So there are many folk dances, but classical dances is largely borrowed from Indian models and is frowned upon by the more severe religious leaders. So, in our life, there are different sort of behavior, different sort of things are present in the mind of Bangladeshi people. They have some sort of way of thinking, they have some sort of understanding, they have some sort of interest and way of life things. If you see the people's way to think is cyclical. Cyclical, I want to say that it's not linear. That as you think that the biblical or westernized culture is very much linear, but the people and the culture of India, including Bangladesh, their thinking and their belief and their culture is based on the cyclical order. Cyclical, I mean, if something is started, that should not be end. But linear process, if there is some starting point and there is some ending point, it will be end at the, finally, there is some ending point. But in the cyclical process, there is no ending point. It is started and it is regenerated and the process is going on for the eternal time. So that is the thinking or life systems or the belief systems of Bangladeshi or Indian people. And the people of Bangladesh, they have some mutual understanding capacity. Mutual understanding capacity, I want to say, they all the time, they incorporated other people's mind, they want to incorporate the other people's interests, other people's choice, and other people's decisions. So all the time, they respect to other people's. That is, that I want to say, mutual relationship is very much significant and stronger in Bangladesh. And the people all the time, most of the peoples, I think 30 to 40% peoples, they are living very lower line of the poverty. But all the time the people are showing their happiness, whether they are taking meal or not, that's not a matter of their lifestyle. They are happy all the time. So that's the people of Bangladesh. And their way of life, actually I want to say, the social life is very much collective. From the very beginning of, I want to say, Muslim regimes, the Muslim, Hindu and Buddha people, they both were living together without any confrontation, without any conflict. The Muslim peoples visited to the house of Hindu peoples and Hindu peoples visited to the house of Muslim peoples without any considerations of their religious differences. Even the Hindu puja, I mean worship, and the Hindu celebrations of different occasion, the Muslim people attended there without any variations of their values. So I want to say there are also some religious harmony in our culture. So that very harmony people has got from the from their historical background, because we have a history of Buddhism, we have a history of Jainism, and we have a history of Hinduism. And that very history has taught the people to learn how to live in with harmoniously, so that the peoples of Bangladesh are very much collective, and harmonious. Okay, the totality of socially transmitted behavior patterns, arts, belief, institutions, and all other products of human works and thought that is dependent on the people, devotion, spirituality, integrity, and there are also some social equality, and that is the cultural background of Bangladeshi people, and that has come from the prehistoric period of Bangladesh. So we have some sort of cultural values, that is devotion, spirituality, and integrity. If you go through the Upanishad, basically the Upanishad that is based on spirituality. On the other hand, devotion, that is the historical point of view of Indian people. I think that was present from the pre-Aryan time of India. And the integrity, that very terms has got from their ancestor like Dravidian people, non-Aryan peoples. Aryan people, they're from outside of India. Okay? That is the basic cultural background of Bangladesh. So I'm talking about the Indus Valley culture or Dravidian Jainism and Buddhism. That's Indo-Bangla culture. I'm talking about Indo-Bangla culture because Bangladesh, that's once, that was a part of India. Strongly prohibited, for example, in the Indo-Bangla culture, there are some prohibitions. For example, the most of the peoples prohibited animal killing and offered to be vegetarian. During Aryan invasions, it was not prohibited. So the cultures before the Aryan and after Aryan, it has made a very strong differences before the culture of Aryan and after the invasion of Aryan people. Most of the pre-Aryan people, they were vegetarian, but the Aryan people like to killing and take protein, animal protein. So these peoples are not follow the norms and principle of vegetarianism. So such a shifting in Indian culture was made possible only because of contributions of Buddhism and Jainism. In the prehistoric period, Indo-Bangla society was animistic society as well as egalitarian. That is very two principles of moral philosophy or ethics. I think animistic society, most of the cases, the animistic society is an egalitarian society. The other question, what is animism? And what is egalitarianism? Now we can explain these two things. Before that, we can see the landscape of India or Indus Valley civilization. That is the map of Indus Valley civilization. There's Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, and Hindu Kush mountain. That's the Brahmaputra river, Himalaya mountain, Ganga river, Bay of Bengal, and this is the Indus Valley civilization. So I'm talking about a old city, that's name is Puari Bateshwar. Actually, we found lot of artifacts from the Indus Valley civilizations and the Wari Bhatishras, which reflected the animistic culture, art, and the belief of these people. Particularly, the environment, living and non-living, has conscious or spirit. What is animism? Animism, that means environment, living and non-living, has conscious or spirit. That all being deserves reverence. According to animism, the belief, all the thing has a life, and that life has a reverence. So that, according to animism, we must have to show respect to the all things, including the plant, animals and also human beings. There is another view, that is pantheism. Pantheism, the natural objects that reflects the view, the natural objects and processes, that nature is sacred or holy and people should have reverence for it. I think animism and pantheism reflected the same views. Pantheism, that means the God is in everywhere. Animism, that means the animality or lifeness is existed in everywhere. But all the cases, in the cases of animism and in the cases of pantheism, life is very important factor, and reverence towards the life is also another important factor. So in many ancient Bangladesh, particularly the Sompur Bihar, that's the old civilization, that's the old archaeological field are existed in Bangladesh, like Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. There are a lot of archaeological artifacts. There are a lot of evidence which depicted the harmony of nature and human beings. We got there a lot of artifacts of arts and a lot of things we got from there, which reflected a views of human and animals and plant relationship. That means we people, the our ancestral people, very much live together with the human beings to human beings, and human beings with animals, human beings with plants. They have a reverence towards the nature, they have a respect for animals, and they have also the mutual lifestyle process. So that is called Sangha. It is found in the Sompur Bihar in Bangladesh. These also things are found in Sompur Bihar. I think that is there's one sort of bird, and that is human beings and birds are together. There's a flower. There's animals. There's maybe fish like that. So, all these artifacts are we found from the archaeological places from Bangladesh, and these artifacts reflect the view that the people of Bangladesh are believe on animism and pantheism, and their lifestyle was very much harmonious, and they believe on mutual relationship with the nature, with the plant, and with the human beings. So there is another question: why the people of Bangladesh were enemies once? Right now, the people are not enemies, but once the people of Bangladesh were enemies, and because of their natural resources, because of their natural diversity, the people had become enemies. And there are also another reasons of our natural diversity, for example, vast rivers, deep forestry, mountains, and beautiful landscape shape the unique form of our culture. There are also some different sort of beliefs like Tantra, Vedism, Jainism, and Buddhism emphasizes the importance of natural environment to maintain the ecological balance. And there is taught the peoples to live a life in harmony with nature and other things. So all these are the views, animist views are present in our culture. This is called Yukshu. Then the form of Yukshu are frequently depicted with the trees holding the branches of standing with one leg and entering around the tree trunk. That's one kind of artifacts we found in our old archaeological places. The Brakshika, that's women and tree are embracing together. That's called Chipu. Chipu may be a Sanskrit or Hindi word. Chipu. Chipu. You don't know? Okay. Chipu, that's together. You know the name Kali, Durga, Mahushu, Moti, All these terms are present in our ancestor religious belief. That is called Brakshita. Women and tree are existing together, are living together. There is another term, that is Naga. Naga, that is serpents or snakes. This emphasizes that they, Naga, that means they are fraternity of spirits. In Hindu Bengal art, I am inspired by deep sense of humanism that shows intense awareness of the unity of all life. I want to say, Naga, that's a serpent, but the serpent was used in a symbolic way or symbolic meaning, and that means fertility of spirits, and that means fertility spirits reflect a view of lifeness. I want to say, in our previous culture or our ancestral culture, the significance and the values of life were incorporated very seriously. That is the main views of our people, ancestral people's cultural belief. So, the nature of Bangladesh has become a holy symbol of holy symbol. Even our nature, non-violence and tolerance have become an inherent part of our culture. Well, the thing I want to say, culture, nature, human beings, and the practices of art are developing together. So all this development all this development reflect a view the people believe on harmony. They like to have a very tolerant life, and they believe on mutual understanding with the human beings, with the other peoples, other religious belief peoples, and the nature, and the plant, and many other things, so on. So, Bangladeshi culture has been enriched by successive waves of migration which were absorbed into the Indo-Bangladesh way of life. That is the second phase of our cultural development. I want to say, there are different cultural background peoples who have migrated and also invasion Bangladesh people, and their culture and our original culture have mixed together, and it makes a different sort of cultural reflection or cultural representations. So we can talk about the Hindu religions that is based on Veda. Veda, there are four Vedas, Rig Veda, Sam Veda, Jajur Veda, and Atharva Veda. That is the central point of these four Vedas. Particularly, we are very much interested on Rig Veda. That is a praise of gods, and there are a lot of lyrics, lot of verses are there talking about the world and the creations of this cosmos and the relationship between the cosmos and the God. Reincarnation, that is the central philosophical point of Hindu or Vedas religions. So, in Hindu Trinity, the Hindu Trinity that is based on Rig Vedas, there is a Brahman, is creator. There is a destroyer, there is a preserver, and there is a creator. Creator, destroyer, and preserver. These three altogether make the Hindu Trinity. There is a Ganesh, son of Shiva and Parvati. And say Krishna, was the ancient god of the Aryans. He is believed to be an early prince who obtained Nirvana. There's another religion that is Jainism, a very old ancient religion in India. So Jainism, the first teachers of Jainism, he was a Rishabdeva, he was the first Tirthankar, inspired people in the name of love and ahimsa. He inspired people to learn love and ahimsa that is non-violence. And 24th Tirthankar, there is a 25th Tirthankar, teachers of Jainism. The first Tirthankar name is Rishabdeva, and the 24th Tirthankar name is, I'm missing the name, maybe Rishabdeva, I forget the name, I will remind you. And the 25th Tirthankar name is Mahavira, Mahavir. He is a final and most prominent exponent or prophet of Jaina religions. Jaina philosophy, that is the fourfold view of the state. The first one is Ahimsa, Satya, that is truthfulness, Asatya, to restrain or to escape from falsifications, and Aparigraha, that is not possessions of other things, that is called sometimes Asteya, don't steal other people's property, Asteya. Oh yeah, his name is Parshobnath, he is the 24th Tirthankar or teachers of Jaina religions or philosophy, Jaina Tirthankar. He visited Tukapum near of Medinipur, you know Medinipur? Yes. A painful journey to Rara, many places of Bengali visited by Mahavira. Parshobnath, he was a teacher of Mahavira, and Mahavira visited many places in Bangladesh. His book name is Akaranga Sutta. Akaranga Sutta is a very big book on Jainism. In this book, he explained a lot of conventions, beliefs, and religious norms of Jainism. So in Jainism, we get the term Padma. Padma, there's a big river in Bangladesh. But that very time, that very term or that very words are coming from the Jaino religious belief of Padmavati. Padmavati, that's the name of a goddess. And regarding her name, the river name is Padma. And the Bahapur, already I told about the Bahapur, there's a Shompur Bihar. These many words are also used in Jainism, that is called Pavan Hari. That means starvations. It is conventions of Jaino rituals from the word Pahar, derived from the word Pavanhar. And Pavanhar, this very Pahapur, name of a place near Bagura, near Rashtrahi, a big city of Bangladesh. And that very Pahapur, this place name is come from the Pavanhar. And Pavanhar, that very word is used in Jainism. There's also Gachi. Gachi, that's many words are used in Jainism. And Gachi, that means village, a small village. It derived from Guccho or Samtutal altogether. That's called Guccho. And these words are used in Jainism. I want to say Jainism that was also practiced in Bengali people. And these are the symptoms, and these are the references of this using or significance of Jainism that are practiced by Bangladeshi people once. And we also know the philosophy of Buddha. He has the three jewels. The first one is Buddha, the teacher; Dharma, the teaching; and Sangha, the community. And this is eightfold path, you know, these things. There's a wisdom, there's a moral discipline, that is called Shila. There's a mental discipline, there is Samadhi. This eightfold path. And then, you know, the religion of Islam. Islam in Southeast Asia, it has continued to spread east after Islam in India, result of trading contacts and Sufi conversion efforts rather than military conquests. In 1800th century, Southeast Asian sailors and ships who were active in trade interacted with Islamic traders after Muslims and gained control of Indian Ocean commerce. Coastal cities were most receptive to Islam, most exposed to a variety of things due to interactions with other cultures through trade. Conversions are generally peaceful. Now believers combine Islamic teaching rituals with elements of local religions. Actually, that was the reasons of receiving Islam in Bangladesh. And these are the five pillars of Islam. Okay, there's the rituals of Islam. And there's sacrificing cattle in Middle Adha. Okay, that's also a question of animal welfare, whether it is right or wrong. That may be ethical questions. But the slaughtering are called Eid al-Adha, they're sacrificing cattle. In every year, the Muslim peoples used to sacrificing cattle in the occasions of Eid al-Adha. Okay, there are another very strong web of cultural background that is called Vaishnavism. Vaishnavism, that's one sort of mixed or syncretizations of Hinduism and Sufism. It's very interesting things. Sufism, that is Islamic pilgrims by Sufi priest and saint, and Chaitanya Deva, you know the great name Chaitanya Deva, his followers, religion name is Vaishnavism. And there's another religious belief that is Baul, sometimes that is called Rupesh Dharma or traditional religions. And these people, Kabir, Nanak, Akbar, Chaitanya, Lalan, they fought a new form of Sufism. As they were great, great people, and they influenced a different sort of, to build a different sort of religious background. That is, here's a Kabir, Nanak, Akbar, and Chaitanya. The bridge between Islam and Hinduism, and their spirituality in Hinduism and spirituality of Islam has got very significant priority in the in their philosophical or religious point of view. So that is the occasion, cultural occasions of Bangladeshi people. For example, Pahla Boishakh, that is the first day of a year, new year, that is called Pahla Boishakh. Year celebration program. Pahla Boishakh, that is the first day of Bangla new year. The day is a public holiday. This day has a special significance for us as it forms a part of Bengali culture and tradition. People from all walks of life, irrespective of their ethnic identity and religious belief, they celebrate the day with traditional festivities. On this day, the whole of Bangladesh is in festive mood. The day inspires people to start life with renewed hopes and inspiration. That's the food item for the Pahla Boishakh. That's a relic for Pahla Boishakh. That's one sort of games are playing in our country. That's also one sort of games, cow games. And that's called palki, like carrying new bride by human beings. Palki. So, I told about Baul, that's a mystic web of Bengal, has a different sort of web in Bengal, that is different from Islam, different from Hinduism, and different from Vaishnavism. But altogether, these people create a new sort of religious belief that is called Baha'u. They are not Islamic followers, even they are not Hindu followers, even they are not Buddhist. They are different sort of, they emphasize on humanity, that human being is all together, with different sort of, irrespective of color, race, and economic conditions, all the peoples are equal. That is the central belief of this traditional mystic orb of religion. They celebrate their occasions like this way. Their main lifestyle is giving their opinion by singing. So the word Baha'u, as I told previously, it refers three terms. Bital, that's bad, out of rhythm. Baha'u, air, the inner flow of energy which gives life and harmony to all sentient beings. And Aulia, a term of Arabic origin which means holy man. The Baha'u reflected these ideas. The Baha'u is a different sort of religious way. From a Hindu or Muslim background, in both cases, they are usually rebels against orthodox practices and social institutions. Usually hailed from backward classes, are mostly abandoned children brought up by other Baha'u gurus, and they live together without marriage, or wander from village to village, or are married people. So, the Baha'u people believe on the God within, that is called Moner Manush. The people live in your mind, the God live in your mind. He has no other existence beyond the human beings, beyond the earth or nature. He lives in the mind of human beings. That's the central point of their religions, the God within. And they don't have any particular religions, and they don't have any idol worship or sacrifices, but they believe on harmony outside and within, and the importance of free thought. Somebody is Muslim, somebody is Hindu, somebody is Buddhist, somebody is Christian. That very consideration is not get priority or emphasizes in their religions. All we are human beings, irrespective of our color, race, and economic conditions, we are human beings. So humanity is the central point of Baha'u. Devotion lies in a commonplace life. Devotion is the central point of Baha'u people. And the belief of brotherhood. We are brother. Any people can get easy access to the Baha'u religions. Everybody can receive this sort of religious belief. So she's singing a Baha'u song. That's the English versions of her song. Oh my heart, do the practice of dying shall bring freedom from the bondage of birth and death, born to die, die to be born again, death, birth, nothing but endless suffering. Oh, and three Vedas, situated in Muladhara, Shodhisthana, and Manipura. This fact the master practitioner knows. He craves not after mundane mortal delights. This one song by a Baha'u singer. That's very interesting reasons we can find in Bangla. There's another song whose central theme is like that. Actually, that is the central philosophy of Baha'u, and their main exponent is Lalon. Throughout the Baha'u, this song, Lalon is expressing that he is becoming puzzled by the word religion, which is uttered everywhere by everyone, while very few are agreed to do for the truth. Lalon, he's the main exponent of Baha'u philosophy, asks why men take birth, are they remain ever in which religion they were taking birth? This is very central questions of Baha'u philosophy. When you born, do you have any religious simple that I'm Muslim, somebody is Hindu, somebody is Christian. No, nobody can say that you're a Muslim, you're a Hindu. And they know at time of the last rite, which religions they would have then. He is also confused in thinking that as the same holy water makes both the Brahmin and the outcast pure and sacred, then why these differences between them in the society? If we are not different in our born, if we are going to the same place after our death, so why are you making differences between the person to person? That I am Muslim, you are a Hindu, somebody is American and somebody is Muslim, or somebody is rich and somebody is poor. Why are you making such kind of differences among the people? So the opposite, such kind of discrimination and differences of human beings on the basis of economic, ritual and racial perspective. We have some ethnic cultural background. You know, Chakma, Mandi, let's call Garo. These are the ethnic community are registered in Bangladesh. Khasi, Sautal. I was there in a program taking smoking. The pattern of smoking, taking smoke like this way. And yes. And they are making cloths like this way, indigenous way. And their lifestyle and livelihood. So, in a nutshell, that is the central theme of our cultural background. Okay? So, to understand bioethics, culture is very important things. Why culture is important? I think without cultural understanding, we never can practice bioethics. Because if you all the time claim that global bioethics is possible, it's quite an impossibility. A global bioethics never can be possible. Because the people, their cultures, their values, their attitude, their linguistic pattern, that, for example, the speaking oil and the understanding and many things are different from person to person. So, if the attitude, culture, values and belief are different, how can we do global bioethics from the different perspectives? So, global bioethics, I think, are quite impossible. So, how can we do bioethics right now? So okay, we are going to the point of bioethics and I'll explain some practices, bioethical practices in Bangladesh. For example, the case of abortion, the case of euthanasia, the case of genetic engineering and cloning, and many items are there. And there are also some challenges that faces Bangladesh peoples to practice bioethics. So, okay, can I give you 5 minutes break?
Do you want a break or you want to continue?
Continue?
Okay. They love to learn. No questions so far?
Do you have any questions?
I think the Bell group was very interesting. I have not heard of them before.
Yeah.
Like a universalist religion.
Sound system is not working.
It's not a... sorry. It's not a question, but it's my point of view.
Yes.
Like, you say that Bangladeshi Muslims are more liberal, like Indian Muslims are also liberal. But according to my point of view, in India there are several other speaking Muslims are there. But they are not so liberal like Bengali Muslims. It's my personal point of view, maybe.
Yeah, I think your observation is very right. I have also some experience with the Indian Muslim people. When the India and Pakistan playing cricket, the Indian Muslim peoples supported Pakistani teams. This seems a wonderful thing. The same things happened in Bangladesh. The Hindu peoples, while Bangladesh and India cricket team is fighting, the Hindu peoples support the Indian teams. Actually, they're doing the things, I don't know, not on the basis of their religious belief, of their previous or historical religious karma. They're doing the things on the basis of their present mindset, how they are thinking about the religions, how they are thinking about the people. Like this way they're thinking. That's also fact. For example, you know, many Muslim people in India are not getting a good job regarding their competency. So that has made a mind against the administrations or governing systems of India. In the same manner, the Bangladeshi Hindu peoples are exploited in terms of many things. They are not getting a good job because of Hindu. They are not getting a good position because of Hindu. In many places of Bangladesh, the powerful people, those who are ruling party, they are capturing the land of Hindu people. And they forced to leave the country to India. And the Indian Hindu people sometimes force the Muslim people to leave to Bangladesh. That has made their mindset to hate the other people, other religious people. The Hindu people hate the Muslim, and Muslim people hate the Hindu peoples. That is a recent phenomenon. But historically, we people have a culture of non-violence, mutual understanding, relationships, and a harmonious lifestyle. So you're right. I think I have that. I have the same observations about the Muslim and Hindu peoples in Bangladesh and India.
Sorry, my question is not Muslim and Hindus. My question is only about the Muslims. You say that Bangladeshi Muslim and the Indian Muslims are more liberal, right? More liberal from their religion point of view or anything. Other Muslims.
Yeah, all compared to other world Muslims.
Yeah. All over
Iranian Muslims or African Muslims.
But according to my point of view, in India, not only the Bengali-speaking Muslims are there, other speaking like Hindi speaking, Urdu, some of them are speaking Urdu, and some of them are speaking Tamil.
Yeah.
They also have other. Yeah. So they are not so liberal like Bengali Muslims, whether they are in India or whether they are in Bangladesh.
This is true, but I think that's a political matter. Political in their sense, for the last 200 years, the Muslim peoples are facing lot of problems from the religious point of view. For example, the British ruled over the Muslim and Hindu peoples for the last 200 years, and after that, we peoples are ruled by Indian power, then ruled by Pakistani power, and that very political history has made the people mindset indifferently. The hate come into the scenario. Before that, the hate and the conflict and the differences were not present in our mindset. Actually, that is a very political invitation, that is a very political matter. So you're right, that most of the Muslim peoples in India are not so good, are not
liberal.
Not liberal.
Understood.
They're orthodox.
Yes.
Yeah, but they're not much orthodox. The politics has made their mindset like this way. So I think that is my observations. Maybe there are different reasons or causes, but I think politics is the matter. Politics is function behind the mindset. Maybe. It's okay. Okay. Right now I'm talking about bioethics. That is very familiar to me, other than culture. I'm not expert of culture, but I think to understand bioethics, culture is very important factor. I think important candidate. Without understanding culture, it's quite impossible to do bioethics. So, how can we understand the term bioethics? You know, bios plus ethics together, we get the term bioethics. Bios, that means life. Ethics, that means values or morality. So, what is bioethics? Bioethics, that is ethics about the life. So, the Greek word for customs or habit, the characteristics, conduct of an individual given life, that is ethos. Ethics, that is come from ethos. Ethos means something like that. The other question is that why ethics is important? Ethics is a requirement for human life. It is our means of deciding a course of actions. For example, when a people fall into danger, we're going to help him. We extend our hand to cooperate him. Why? Because that is the nature of human beings. And that very nature is called ethos of human beings, or values of human beings, norms of human beings. That's normal things. So how can we define ethics? Actually, there is academic definitions. The term ethics means as a discipline, and that is studying and talking about what is right and what is wrong, what is good and bad. It is also studying what makes something good or bad. This helps decide whether other things are good or bad. That's the definitions of ethics. He's a Rennesley Potter. He's a bioethicist. He defined bioethics, biology combined with diverse humanistic knowledge, for being a science that sets a system of medical and environmental priorities for acceptable survival. He defined bioethics in this way. The term bioethics can be understood from biological and ethical perspective together, according to his definitions. How can we understand bioethics? According to Potter, we understand bioethics from the biological and ethical perspective. So, the term bioethics can be understood from two perspectives. There are two perspectives or issues, biological issues and moral issues. Potter's expositions of bioethics, in my consideration, fails to grasp the leading issue of bioethics. Actually, his definition implies that bioethical problems get ethical considerations only for assessing the controversy of medicine, healthcare, and health-related technology. So, bioethics, a field of study concerned with ethics and philosophical implications of certain biological and medical procedures, biotechnologies, and treatments, such as organ transplants, genetic engineering, and fear of the terminally ill people. All these things are the concerning issue of bioethics. I'm going to talking about the Universal Declarations of Bioethics and Human Rights by UNESCO, Universal Framework of Principles and Procedures they have, and they emphasize many things. We found a lot of articles in the declarations. The Article 6, they emphasize on consent. Article 9, they emphasize on privacy and confidentiality. Article 11, they emphasize on non-discriminations and non-stigmatizations. Already Professor Messer explained these things. And Article 13, that is explained solidarity and cooperation. Article 19, that is Ethics Committee. Ethics Committee, that's very significant. Most of the countries, they have a Ethics Committee, but I think most of the countries in Asia and Africa, the state or any research organizations or university, they don't have any Ethics Committee. They don't bother about the Ethics Committee. And Article 21, transnational practices. For example, organ transplantation. That is the issue of right now, in the medical tourism, organ transplantation is an issue of transnational issues. For example, in India, particularly in Bombay and Kolkata, there are a lot of medical practitioners and hospitals. They are doing the things of organ transplantations. But most of the cases, there are scarcity of organs. So how can they collect organs? In that cases, they're using neighbor poor countries and poor people. By giving money, they are trafficking people from the other countries in the name of giving job and immigrations. So that very issue is not a national issue, that is transnational issues involved with the South Asian countries. For example, the central point involved with the organ transplantation is existed in Kolkata, and the peoples, those who are giver of organs, coming from Bangladesh or Nepal or Bhutan. So this issue is not within the territory of India. That issue is a transnational. I mean, many countries are involved with this issue. So there are a lot of bioethical issues are not the issues of any particular state or country. So right now, question is very important. Why we'll do bioethics? Why bioethics is important? You know, there's issues of abortion. You know, there's a health risk. And in the case of abortion, there is a destroying life, unexpected baby. These are the cases related to abortion. And there are also some infectious diseases like HIV/AIDS. For the question of securitization. For example, we have a stigmatization toward the HIV/AIDS patient. Oh, he's infected by HIV/AIDS, so we're not mixed with him. He found no persons, the male or female, never whimsically or willingly get married to these very people because he's infected by some very dangerous diseases. So how can we treat these people? Would we securitize these people? Will quarantine these people? Don't go outside or don't mix with other peoples. Don't talk to other peoples. You must be quarantined in this house. Don't go outside. Would we do this? If we do these things, that will be violations of human dignity. That will be violations of human freedom and liberty. So what will we do? A person cannot be causes of harm to others. For example, if we make free these people to mix any other peoples without disclosing the information about his medical conditions or disease conditions, then he or she can make friendship with other peoples and getting free sex with the peoples, and such a way he can infected other peoples. So that is very dangerous things. So how can we control these issues? How can we govern the problem of HIV/AIDS patient? Will we quarantine these people or securitize these people? Or how can we deal these issues? That one issue is a bioethical issue. And there's also experimentations of animals in laboratory. You know, there's a question of welfare and naturalness of experimentations. For example, you're doing research with mice. So you're keeping mice from the field and holding these things in a particular places. That's very much, he's a quarantine in a particular places, and you are giving some particular kind of food and treatment to this animal. But we are not considering the ethology of mice. They have some particular sort of natural environment. They have some particular environment to develop his bodily or many sort of things are there. So do you have any right to exploit his own ethological and behavioral condition to constraint? Do you have that? No. We cannot do it. So that there is the issue of bioethics. And there is a trial of new medicines. Did something go wrong? the rich country produced medicine, and they sent these things for trial to the African poor countries and Asian poor countries people. That is called clinical trial. Is clinical trial ethically accepted? There's also issues for bioethical concern. There's also biotechnology. What is the impact of biotechnology on the human subject and environment? We are doing biotechnology. For example, in my country, there are at least 20 or 25 new public universities. Most of the universities are biotechnology department, biochemistry department, and most of the brilliant students are going there. But they don't know. If we ask the students, why you are coming to study biotechnology? Okay, biotechnology is a very new field of science, bioscience, so that is a new opportunity for my job and new opportunity for doing research. So this is why I chose biotechnology. But behind the biotechnology, they don't know the ethical questions. They don't know about the ethical acceptability of biotechnology. So that is also issue of bioethics. At a glance, you just see the ethical, bioethical issues. Lot of things are there. Now, already I told these things. Reproduction. Okay. Okay, right now we are talking about the case of organ donations. Suppose a people need to transplant a heart. These are the people are admitted in hospital. He's a poor people, an aged. He's a 20 years old beautiful girl, and 80 years old man, and 35 years old, 35 years old scientist. He has a lot of perspectives in his future life. So you have one heart available for the one heart are available in the hospital. So how can they distribute this heart among these four peoples? One heart can distribute to one people. It's not possible to distribute four peoples. So how can the medical decision maker or medical doctors take the decisions to transplant one heart among the four people? Can you understand my question? What would be the possible conditions or requirements to distribute this heart among these four people? That's a bioethical question. Think about. People in coma, no chance to live, but have a severe pain. What you should do? A people, he is admitted in a hospital. He has no chance. He is in coma, and no chance to survive. So in that case, would he do withdraw his medicine and food that is called
ventilation?
Do you have any right, or do you have right for the patient? So how can you take decisions in this dilemmatic situation, in these problematic situations? Okay, so people with spinal cord injury, no chance to survive. This neonatal baby, at least possibility of survival with lot of physical. Do you kill him? Do you have an answer? No. And there is another issue that is sacrificing cattle. So how can we treat this thing? So these are the problem of bioethics, right now I'll give some examples of scenario of bioethics that is practices in Bangladesh. What is the reality of practices bioethics in Bangladesh? I think
at the governmental level, there is no any sort of bioethical plan and policy, as far as I know. And even there is no national bioethics committee in my country right now. In order to handle some specific cases, there is a big medical university in Bangladesh that is called Postgraduate Medical University. They follow some ethical principle, but they don't have any organized committee yet they established. There are some responsible persons giving the decisions on the basis of their elementary knowledge. I think they don't have any academic knowledge to take decisions in the case of critical situations. For example, euthanasia. For example, the natal problems or the case of abortions. These very things are very much critical regarding the religious point of view and cultural point of view of Bangladesh. So this medical has no any specialized bioethicist, and they don't have any bioethics committee to take the decisions. Bangladesh Bioethics Society is working to promote strong ethical balance practices of ethics and morality among different stakeholders for preventing corruption, upholding human rights, and promoting good governance. That is established in 2009. That is privately organized. We are working, Professor Messer also working there, helping to develop this community. It was established in 2009 under the auspice of Regional Unit for Social and Human Science in Asia and the Pacific, UNESCO Bangkok and UNESCO Dhaka together. It is a non-profit, non-political, multidisciplinary and voluntary organization. That's the first bioethics community in Bangladesh. They are working for giving bioethical decisions. But that is not enhanced by government. That's very privately. So, what are the problems of bioethics, bioethical practices in Bangladesh? This is a very important question to understand bioethics in Bangladesh. I think our curriculum, education system, and the curriculum is a problem for doing bioethics. Actually, bioethics, that is very multidisciplinary discipline. Once that was a subject matter of philosophy as a branch of ethics. Bioethics was practiced in different places, but right now different people are doing bioethics, particularly the bioscience researcher, medical practitioners, and biotechnology researcher, they are also doing bioethics. So bioethics is a multidimensional discipline. If one can understand bioethics, he must have to know or respect to other discipline, to other knowledges of science. Otherwise, it's quite impossible to understand bioethics. So to understand bioethics, it also needs moral philosophy, because without utilizing or applying moral principles, one never can give any decisions. One never can come to the point of decisions without applying the moral philosophy or ethical theories. So bioethics have been developed in West as a multidisciplinary in nature. I want to say bioethics is a multidisciplinary. Bioethics incorporates the knowledge of legal, religious, secular, cultural, biological science, theology, and social sciences. So that is the approaches of multidisciplinary knowledge. And field of healthcare, medical practitioners including nurses, case of reproduction and reproductive technology, issue of family relationship, and the impact of new science and technology. So many people are involved with the system of medical practices and healthcare practices. So to take any decisions in the problematic situations, a person individually or alone cannot take a very quiet and perfect decisions. So he or she needs different sort of knowledges. For example, the healthcare professionals has need to take decisions in critical situations. But he or she cannot take the decisions alone. She needs lot of knowledge. She needs lot of approaches. So that I want to say, bioethics, that is a multidimensional and multidisciplinary approaches. That's not purely philosophy, that's not purely science, that's not purely technology or biotechnology. Actually, bioethics, that's a totality of different knowledges, including religion. So, I'm talking about the bioethics of Bangladesh. We have an education policy that was launched 2010, that is called Education Policy 2010. In this education policy, the government indicates that specialized knowledge creates discursiveness in the field of knowledge. Therefore, it taught to increase interdependency of different branches of knowledge. As a result, science and technology, sociology, literature, arts, economics, and others, science will be included there. In our education policy, the government understands that knowledge should be multidimensional. So I appreciate these things. But in Bangladesh, when we are doing bioethics, it has been suffering a lot of challenges. The first challenge is a poverty. The second challenge is lack of multidisciplinary. It was declared in our education policy, but in practice, I observed most of the university, they don't have any multidimensional discipline. For example, the medical students, I am talking about the government universities and colleges. For example, we have a lot of medical colleges. And most of the cases, the medical college students are not concerned about, they know what is euthanasia, but they are not concerned about the ethics of euthanasia. They know what is abortion, but they are not concerned about the morality of abortions. So why? Already the government has declared to follow the multidimensional knowledge in the academic level. But in the practice, we don't find any sort of multidimensional or multidisciplinary approaches in our curriculum. That is the main problem. We are saying something, but we are not doing the same things. That is another problem of our education systems and governance systems. So our curriculum is not value-free. There are another challenges for bioethics in Bangladesh. There are lack of guidelines in education policy. Problems of allocation of healthcare resources and rights of people. We don't know what sort of resources will allocate it among the people. Who will get priority? The poor people or the rich people? Or the people, those who are living city, big city, or those who are living the peripheral side of the country. For example, in our peripheral side of our country, like Sylhet, Rajshahi, Rangpur, there's the name of a big city in Bangladesh. The most of the peoples are living in the below the line of poverty. They do not take meal three times in a day. So it's quite impossible to get medicine or hospitality by their own means. So in that case, the government must provide medical equipment, medical resources, and medical medicine. All these things should be provided by the government. But most of the cases, these people are not getting such kind of corporations. So this is a question: how do we distribute the health resources? If there is any scarcity of health resources, how can we distribute these things among the people? Who will get the priority? And those people will get first. This is the main problem of doing bioethics in Bangladesh. There is also another problem, equalizing access to healthcare and medicines, already I told. Ensure that science and technology are put in the service of promoting public health. There is another challenge, and that his ethical decisions are interfered by personal choice, social and cultural values. For example, in Bangladesh, politics is very important things. The political leader, those who are in power, they have a right to impose the decision. If a political leader says something, that is the decisions for the community. So other ethical or religious or any sort of moral decision should not be get access there. So political leader decision is the main. So in that case, the values and social harmony and the other things will not get priority there. So that is another problem. I think our society system right now, for the last 400 years, our society system is a paternalistic. You know, paternalism? That is, father is the chief. For example, in a family, I know the Japanese social system is also paternalistic. Father is chief, guardian is chief. If guardian says that don't do these things, the other members don't have any right to do the same things. Is it? Okay, that is called paternalistic system of culture. So for the last 400 years, our culture and value system are very much paternalistic. Father dominating. If there is no father, the elder brother would be the pattern. He will giving the decisions. And for example, if she is a younger member of her family, she cannot take marry by herself without permissions of her older brother. This is the reality in my country, is it? I don't know about the Japan. Mm-hmm. Same things?
Not so same, but the father is very...
Very near. Yeah, approximate. So there are also some emotional and conventional factor. Emotional, that means most of the people are Muslim. So if they are doing something beyond the Islamic cultures and Muslim culture, that will not be received very worldwide. You are doing something against Islam, so you cannot do it. So it's quite very difficult things to handling the practices of bioethics in Bangladesh. That is the challenges, emotional challenges for bioethics. So, I'm talking about the multidimensional perspective of our education system. We are talking about the, for example, if you're doing animal biotechnology in a university or in a governmental level, we must have to follow what is the environmental impact of this biotechnology. We must have to follow the impact on human health, animal welfare, and the question of naturalness and playing with God. For example, when you're doing biotechnology, the God, if any person is a believer, he must believe that God created us and God created everything. So the human being has no right to create anything differently. If the persons are doing so, that is the playing God. So the religious people can criticize, oh, you are doing something, you are playing something with God, because you are doing something outside of the God dominations, outside of the God creations, outside of the God governance. So that is the against the belief of God. So that it is called playing God. So that very criticism is coming from the religious philosopher, theologist. So that is also challenges for bioethics. So all these issues are required to discuss. I think the societies that have values, norms, culture, religions, and the people have interest, and the interest of environment deserves due concern. Therefore, any kind of bioscience need to incorporate philosophical, anthropological, normative, and scientific knowledge. Without doing such kind of knowledge, it's quite impossible to do science, but whether it is bioscience or biotechnology, animal biotechnology or medical science or medical technology, whatever the things, without receiving this knowledge, it's quite difficult to do such kind of sciences. So from the very beginning of my lecture, I said bioethics must be multidisciplinary. That should not be based on philosophy. That should not be based on only biotechnological knowledge or medical knowledge or medical technology. If we are doing bioethics, that must be multidimensional, multidisciplinary. There should be theology, there should be environmental science, there should be technology, there should be philosophy, there should be moral philosophy, and sociology, anthropology also there. Okay? So, just an observation. Among the students of his schools, we ask the questions, do you think about bioethics? What is the scenario? I observe that practicing bioethical principles by high school students and college students have increased from about 20% in the early 90s and to 40% today. Before 10 years, most of the school students or college students don't know what is bioethics, what is the purposes of bioethics, what are the functions of bioethics. But right now, the students can speak about bioethics, the students know what is bioethics. Maybe they don't have any vast knowledge, elaborate knowledge, but they have a knowledge about bioethics. They have a knowledge of what is the function of bioethics. So I think that is a big development of bioethical practices in Bangladesh. Okay. So in bioethics, already we told about consent. Actually, that is called informed consent. While you are doing bioethics, the informed consent, that is a great requirement. Without understanding informed consent, we never do bioethics. So right now, we must have to know what is informed consent. Actually, informed consent, that is a key instrument in protecting the right of a subject. That is informed consent. For example, I may be subject of a research, but before asking any question or giving a list of questionnaire, you must have to give my consent, whether I will participate in your research or not. Or you cannot impose me to answer of any questions. Or you cannot disclose any confidential information that you have got from my side. For example, that may be my family confidential matter, that may be my health confidential matter I'm giving you. But you don't have any right to disclose these information to other people. You must follow these things. And there should be very autonomous relationship between participant and researchers. Me is a participant, you are a researcher. You are asking me a lot of questions. Or, you know the story of Tuskegee syphilis research? No, you don't know? Tuskegee, there's a place in USA, United States, and a group of researchers under the government health organizations, they are doing research among the syphilis attacked people, infected people. And they, more than 400 people, they took as a participant. Maybe 100 people, they are giving medicine and many things to see the impact of medicine, and the rest of the 300 people who are not taking any medicine, just to see what had happened without taking medicines of a syphilis patient. You know? But the researcher did not inform what are they doing. Even sometimes they are giving placebo treatment to the patient. Placebo treatment. the treatment in a name, but that is not a real treatment. That is called placebo treatment. So the Tuskegee syphilis patients were getting placebo treatment, and that was very dangerous event happened in this event. Maybe 300 or 400 patients had died without taking any medicine, without taking any medical considerations. And that was published after long times during the Bill Clinton tenure. And Bill Clinton says sorry to the participant. What has happened there? That happened, the problem of informed consent. Without any informations, without giving any informations, without taking any consensus, they are doing research among the people. So that is a dangerous thing. So informed consent is very critical and very potential issues in doing bioethics. Without practicing informed consent, it is quite impossible to do bioethics. So you must have to understand what is informed consent. Informed consent assures that prospective research subjects will understand the nature of the research and can knowledgeably and voluntarily decide whether or not to participate. You have that right, you have that freedom, whether you will participate in the research or not. But the researcher don't have any right to enforce the subject or participant to participate in the research. For example, I am giving consent, okay, I will participate in your research. But after some while, or after some days, I can withdraw myself from your research. You never can request me. You never can convince me. You never can force me. That is the autonomy of a participant or researcher. So that are the inner factors, inner requirements of informed consent. The fundamental ethical duty of respect for persons requires that we do not act against a person's wishes. In a research or in anywhere. For example, the government is taking a decision where the government claims that very decisions will give a great opportunity for the people. But the people are not receiving this opportunity. They protest against the declarations of the government. No, we are not. We are not acknowledged. We don't conform with your declarations. So the government has no right to launch any declarations or law without consent of the people or citizens of a state. Firstly, the government should give information to the people. From the other side, the citizens will give the consent to the government. The consent why may be different, that may be voting systems. For example, in all the Brexit in Europe, whether the England will be out from the European Union, that is done by the voting system. The government cannot give by herself or himself any decisions whether they will be in with European Union or out from the European Union. So that's the process of informed consent. So informed consent is a process which is designed to empower the individual to make a voluntary informed decisions regarding participation in the research. It's clear? Okay, that's very important. Empower the individual to make a voluntary informed decisions. The informed decision should be voluntary. That should not be involuntary, that should not be non-voluntary. Okay? Sorry. Okay. So what happens in Bangladesh regarding informed consent? Just 10 minutes. It's okay?
It's up to them.
10 minutes? Is too much? Okay, just 10 minutes. Firstly, we can assume that in the case of research and doctor-patient relationship, the prevailing form of informed consent in Bangladesh is paternalistic. Actually, I'm talking about the cultural system of Bangladesh. That's too much paternalistic. Paternalistic, that means the guardian and the father is in superior, the other are subjects, inferior. So if the father or guardian give any decisions, that should be obeyed by other members of the family without any raising questions. That is the nature of paternalism. So why our culture is paternalistic? And what is paternalism? Just after giving the understanding of these things, I will stop my lecture. Okay? The first argument is based on the fact that researchers, doctors are generally in the best positions to know what is the best options for participant, patient, because of their specialized knowledge. What is paternalism? There is always a violation of patient autonomy, though perhaps justified depending on circumstances. And that are the different aspects of paternalism. The researcher should make all the decisions for a participant. Paternalism in the case of research. For example, the researchers are doing research and he knows everything. He or she knows everything. She never informed anything to the participant or subject or his or her associates. Researcher says, I know everything. Don't ask any questions. That is the main problems of paternalism. People are not always rational, mature. The researcher thinks so. Experts know better about the needs of participants and the society. Qualified researchers have good aim. So our culture, value orientation, belief system has made our mind such kind of paternalistic mind. Culture is very, basis of paternalism, culture. Culture is the main basis of paternalism. Not only that, in our society there are also some structural inequality, I want to say, for example, in a family there are 10 members, but that very 10 members are dependent on one member. So there are sort of inequality because the other members cannot earn, so he has no any voice. He's a silent. He cannot give any voice. Oh, you cannot earn. You cannot run in life. So why you are giving different voice? So I am not helped to give you any opportunity from my side. So that's one kind of threaten for the other members. So that's the one kind of problems for informed consent. And that is the reasons, that is the basis of paternalistic attitude. And there are also desirable conditions to survive. And social structure, our societal system is feudalism, and there is also hierarchical dictum, you know, feudalism, there is a feudal, and there are also subject, and the relationship between feudal and subject is hierarchical. All the time the feudal is superior and the subject is inferior. The relationship is a relationship of exploitations. All the time feudal people dominate over the inferior. So you don't have any right to say anything. You don't have any voice. This is the main problem of paternalism. So all these are the cultural phenomena what has made our mind paternalistic. I'm not saying in favor of paternalism. Actually, paternalism, that's a very much problematic to do informed consent. And that very problematic things are exist in our society. In my society, I'm talking this thing. Our national culture, religious influence, lifestyle, dependency, scarcity of expertise, and limitations of income, generating means, family culture. On the basis of national culture, we follow the seniors' attitudes and values. All the time, the seniors are great priority in our society. And father or elder, the rest of the members are dependent on father or elder brothers. Scarcity of expertise. In the case of research, the researcher knows better because he thinks that other people are not expert in this sort of discipline. So I know better. So if any person claims that he knows better, he all the time will overrule in the situation. He thinks himself a superior. So other people are inferior. So there are a lot of things are doing in Bangladesh. For example, the case of abortion, there are also some problem and debate and controversy, and there are also case of euthanasia, IVF in vitro fertilization case, and euthanasia case. Okay, there are also controversy. Lot of things are there. Okay. Organ donation. Already we explained about organ donation. There are many sort of problem in organ donations. Whether we can receive the organs of cadaveric persons or living persons or relatives or anybody else. That's one problem. Another problem is organs allocations, organ scarcity, organs queue. All these are the problems involved with the organ donations. This is also bioethical problem. There's also, we are doing biotechnology in our public university, and there are also some issues of in the case of HIV/AIDS. We talked about these things. Okay, so there are many things we can discuss, but in a class it's quite impossible to discuss everything. So that is the point about bioethics, and we are doing bioethics in Bangladesh. So, okay.
Do you have some questions? Please ask him some questions.
So we are belonging in HIBO program, and there are some international students from Bangladesh. So many of them are Muslim, but some of them is strict, but some of them not so strict. So what is the difference happen between Muslim people?
Oh, okay. So for example, I myself is a serious secular person. I don't have any serious belief on any sort of religion. So I have that right. I born in a Muslim community, but that was not my decision, whether I was born in a Muslim community or a Christian community or a Buddhist community. But taking knowledge, by getting knowledge, by getting information, I can amend my thinking, I can amend my belief, I can amend my any sort of direction of life. So that is my life, that is my skill. So if I born in a Buddhist family, if I born in a Hindu family, that doesn't imply I must be a Hindu, I must be a Muslim, I must be a Christian. Firstly, I'm a human being. Secondly, my learning, my lessons, my knowledge will make myself, will make my mindset. For example, from the very beginning, when I was a student of primary school and high school, one of my teachers, he was a very much atheist and a materialist. He was involved with a social movement. And I have got touch with this great person, my teachers. And he learned me what is the original reasons of evolution, creation, and the existence of God, and the human beings and the human positions in the society and the relationship of the human beings and the his mode of productions. With this mode of productions, what sort of relationship he will make with the society. All these things were explained by my teachers. And I have got such kind of knowledge that religion, that is one sort of projections of human mind. Or creation, that is the evolutionary process, or many sort of things I have got from the religious learning, theological learning, and materialistic learning. So I have made my mind set in a different way from my other brothers. So I may be atheist, I may be materialist, I may be religious, I may be a Muslim, or I may be nihilist. That, I think that is my exposition, that is my building, that is my learning. That very learning will make my mindset. So different people can be react to the religions in a different ways. So this is why some people are praying five times, they are taking Ramadan, and they are following different religious practices, but some people cannot do it. Firstly, you must see whether the people is honest, he is truthful, or he is a very good person. I think that may be a consideration of a human being. Whether he is a good Muslim or whether he is a good Hindu, I think that's not a first consideration to treat a human being. So the difference is like that.
Thank you.
Yeah? Okay.
We have a couple of questions.
Yes.
I don't know, Manuel or Atanasio, if you can speak. Manuel is in Barcelona, Atanasio is in Mozambique. Do you have any? Can you speak, Manuel?
What about?
Questions for you. Manuel, okay, Atanasio? Yes, I'm getting you now. Go ahead.
Okay. My question as a Briton, I wanted to know what is the role of a bioethicist in relation between the culture and the religion? There are some circumstances whereby culture tends to work and end with the religious issues, and there are circumstances whereby religion tends to be left far away from the culture. In this perspective, what is the role of bioethicists in relation to these two realities which make a human identity? What can a bioethicist do in that those realities, cultural realities as well as religious realities, can harmonize or build the well-being of a human being in any given society? That's what is my question. Thanks.
Okay, as I can understand this question, that is a cultural relativism and bioethics, whether global bioethics is possible or not possible. Actually, from the very beginning of my bioethics lecture, I said global bioethics is impossible. Well, yeah, that's a one kind of utopia. There is a global bioethics, but it is utopia. I think many people have a many religious belief and cultural background. So it's quite impossible to generalize a decision for the all people, irrespectively their cultural and religious belief. Suppose I'm a Muslim community. So when I'm doing my life in Muslim community, I must have to follow the rules and principle of Muslim community. So in that case, it's quite impossible to follow any other principles, or the Muslim community will not encourage any other Christian or Hindu principles to take any sort of decisions. So in that case, we must have to encourage, we must have to follow the norms and values of particular culture and particular religious values. So suppose you know, the Fiji people, most of the cases, they love to take the flesh of their ancestor, but it is quite impossible to think for a normal society to take flesh or meat of their ancestor after their death. It's one sort of conventions in a Fiji community. But that very convention is quite impossible to practice in a particular society. So that practices means our culture and values are relative. So that very relativity implies it's quite impossible to do global bioethics. The bioethics should be particular, the bioethics should be local. But global bioethics, there should be some suggestions, there should be some implications, there should be some guideline, there should be some governance that can govern the bioethics around the world, how they are doing, how the bioethics are working in a different places of the world. But it's quite impossible to practice global bioethical principles. I think cultural relativism is a very great actor or candidate in that case. It's okay?
Yeah, thank you. Do you have any questions before you?
From my side, it's okay. I
understood
the things, so
okay.
I don't have such questions.
Okay.
Love will reflect the same manner to you, to me, and to Professor Messer, and to other peoples. This love. And desire, need food, need hunger, and feelings hunger, feeling pain. I'm getting pain on my left eyes. So that very pain would be the same to other peoples. So if the feeling is same, if the feelings of love is same, if the system of distribution is same around the world, we can receive the conceptions of these terms conceptually, not materially. For example, how can we understand the term equality? In the case of John Rawls, suppose he will say us, if the people are less opportunity, less advantages, give more to these people. And if some peoples have more opportunity, more advantages, just stop these people to provide or allocate it some things or opportunity or commodity to these people. But here one kind of discriminations are occurring to maintain the balance or to maintain the balance of equality or dimension of equality. So, you know, 2 + 2 = 4. 2 + = 4, that is a mathematical equation. In the society, that very equation is not functioning in the same manner. Some people can take two egg together, and some people cannot take this egg together because of his or her food habit or his or her body constructions or body need. So need-based approach would be function here, would be working here. If you get the policy of a need-based policy, for example, you need, my need, and other people need, if we consider in the case of problem, then we can reach to a good solution. I think need, other than right-based approach, we can follow the principle of need-based approach. So the need of Christian people, when a people are living in the dimension of Christianity, when a people are live in his own Muslim belief or Hindu belief or Jewish belief, these very people will take in their decisions of their own way. And that very, you cannot ignore the belief of Muslim people, you cannot ignore the belief of Christian people, you cannot ignore the belief of Jewish people. From the particular aspect, from the particular standpoint, all they are right. So if the people are right from their particular belief systems, we'll treat them according to their need. So if you follow the principle of need, principle of necessity, then you can solve a very critical situation. I think that may be an offer.
Would you introduce your background of the philosophy of religion? Like I'm Hindu or I'm Christian or some sect, very particular sect, everything. But should we not talk about anything? Or shall we introduce myself, who we are, to going forward to other bioethics?
Okay, this is secular questions. We can do, for example, Bicham and Childress, they are doing secular bioethics. There is no place of religion.
Well, Childress is Catholic.
Yes.
He says he's Catholic and he promotes that.
Yes.
Yep. But they're trying to formulate their ethical principles to all people of all religious faiths.
Yes.
Yep.
But we don't find any religious belief in their four principles.
Well, again, how do we define religious belief? They're formulating.
We can compare this belief with, for example, his autonomy system. We can find it in Islam, in Bible, and in Buddhism. But that very autonomy and the autonomy of Islam and the autonomy of Buddhism is not similar. So that's a secular bioethics. So we can do secular bioethics, secularism, secular bioethics.
If you are secular, but if you, Ro is saying he's Shinto, so he comes, or he may be Christian Shinto, and so he comes from that perspective. So some people like to identify, the same if I'm Apache, I want to identify that I'm Apache, and I may follow this and that, so that's fine.
So we have to follow some middle point, that is golden mean.
It depends. If you're talking from your culture, maybe you may want to bring together. So if you're an ecumenical discussion, you want to know that, okay, you're from this particular perspective, but you're talking in what you think will be a secular, well, a cross-religious approach.
But I think there's a problem, because, for example, if I take a stand on the basis of Islam, and if you take a stand on the basis of Catholic Christianity, and somebody if stand on the basis of Buddhism, what would be the possible solutions of the problem?
Well, because I know that all those three religions have every realm of bioethics belief, it's sort of, I would educate them in their own religion and say, you may say that you're taking a stand from Islam, but actually you're taking a stand that maybe a Shiite interpretation of this fatwa, which is in contrast to another person who's even Shiite or Catholic, so, or Buddhist. So we can say our personal belief system, and we can also claim that our personal belief system doesn't affect our religion, our practice of bioethics. But what Ro is saying is, shouldn't I also say that, okay, I think that I'm talking a secular way, but as for example, you mentioned you grew up in a Muslim family, but you are now secular. So you gave your identity.
Yeah.
Somebody who's Catholic, I grew up Catholic, but now I'm Protestant, or I...
But I cannot establish my identity in my society. Because, for example, if I said that, I'll not go, I'll not entertain any sort of Muslim norms. It will not be accepted. It will not be well received in my community. I'll face some problems, or other people may face some problems. So I must have to incorporate some things with my community.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. And
so
then
here's some problem. So I think your question is very, very, very significant and very valid. We must have to find out the answer to your questions, and I think our perspective should be a relative perspective. That may be cultural relativism, that may be religious relativism or fellow relativism. So otherwise, it's quite impossible to receive or to follow any sort of universal moral principle. For example, I want to say about Confucianism. Those who believe on Confucianism, they have some sort of belief, they have some sort of respect to the principles. But in a particular situations, that Confucian belief may be contrast to the Buddhist belief. So if any Buddhist take a stand on behalf of his position, it's quite impossible to take any common decisions. So in that positions, in that situations, we must say our decision should not be followed by seriously followed by cultural religions. That should be followed by in a secular position, and that should be followed by, I think, the degrees of the situation or nature of the situation should be considered here, and the subjective position should be considered here. Subjectivity, I want to say, in a particular situations, my mental state or my mindset would be worked in a different way. So that very different state, mental state, should be considered when you're taking any sort of decisions. So I think bioethics cannot function alone. Psychology and psychological understanding is also functioning here, if I'm not wrong. Do you have any different opinion? Hello?
Well, maybe Manuel, would you like to come in? You have a question. Manuel was going to, it is related to culture and religion.
Hello?
Yes. Yeah, Manuel, go ahead.
Yes, my question has been partly answered, but is what is the Bangladeshi bioethical idea current or author which has found more reticence when brought to the global north?
Okay, in Bangladesh, Beecham and Childress for principalism is very well known to doing bioethics. Okay? Most of the case, for example, we have some cases of euthanasia, okay? withdrawing medical aid or opportunity from a patient. In that cases, we have observed the medical doctors and the hospital taking the decisions on the basis of the family consent. And but there are also some controversy in Islam. You know, most of the Muslim scholars, particularly the Orthodox Muslim scholars, believe that life is holy, life is sacred. So that very sacred life cannot withdraw or cannot give by any people or persons. That is given by Allah or the great creator. So he can right to give life to people, and he has right to withdraw the life from the people. So the people or persons cannot interfere there. So if we give the supporting systems of a coma attacked patient or a serious ill patient who has no chance to live, who has no chance to live, if we give such kind of scientific or medical technological support to save the life, it is not allowed in Islam from the Orthodox point of view. But there is another narrations, another interpretations of liberal Islam. But most of the cases that liberal expositions are not well concerned, well received in Islam. So there's a problem of interpretations.
And Manuel was asking something from Bangladesh that has bioethics that is shared to the global community. Can you think of something from Bangladesh that is shared?
Something?
From Bangladesh, a Bangladesh bioethics principle that is more useful for the global community.
Actually, okay, this is a very important question, but I did not find such kind of
example yet. I think. But there is, in South Asia, one of the things I think is interesting is the diversity of opinion.
Yeah.
So the diversity intrinsic of people are quite articulate, and they will speak with different opinions to each other.
Yeah.
And this diversity can be expressed even quite hotly, but respected.
Yeah.
So this is this pluralism.
Yeah.
Is something which also was a theme in your talk and in the talk of Professor Panaselvam this morning,
yeah.
That the plurality, that may be, I think, an export, because the dogmatism of some belief system in Europe, that they, some cultures said, okay, this is what the Queen says, we should follow that. This is what the Parliament says, the orthodoxy. So that's one thing, but it's not always seen, because we have fundamentalism as well, where people are saying we have to think in this way.
But I have a question regarding plurality.
Yeah.
Actually, have there any real sense plurality are practiced in Asia or South Asia or Bangladesh or in India?
I think, yes, the plurality of respect for different religions is more there.
But we have a lot of instances where the Hindu peoples are killing the Muslim people, and Muslim peoples are killing the Hindus people.
Mm.
And they are in conflict without any reasons, without any ground. They are conflicting each other. So in that case, how can you think that plurality is welcome there?
I see. Well, for example, Thailand with a middle way. So Buddhist middle way is that despite the strong views, we leave people to make a pragmatic decision themselves.
But there is another instance in Myanmar.
Yeah.
The Myanmar Buddhist people, Theravada Buddhists, they're the most orthodox people, but they're expelling some peoples from Myanmar to Bangladesh because of their Muslim identity, because of their difference identity.
Well, this is more Rohingya identity.
Yeah, Rohingya. Do you think that Buddhism or Theravada Buddhism is working in the mind of the Buddhist people?
I think...
And another point,
About Myanmar first, there are over 100... Yeah, there's around 100 ethnic groups officially recognized in Myanmar, but there are two in particular which are not recognized, and one is the Rohingya, and another is Chinese Burmese.
Yeah.
So these two, are because they're excluded, officially not recognized. So yes, you're correct, the pluralism, it exists because of the respect for ethnic groups, but it is limited by certain groups being excluded from the recognition. So it's a limited pluralism.
How can they are doing these things? Why that these peoples are living there for the last 400 years?
But it's political, I think. Political and racial.
Yeah, you know, the philosopher George Agamben, he called this situation as a state of exception. State of exceptions.
Right.
Where there is no rules, no law, the people, those who are superior, they can do anything.
Well, they make new laws, which... Yeah. So, in fact, they make laws, but the laws are not ethical.
Yeah. So, it's quite impossible to say pluralism is functioning here in a consistent way.
It's maybe functioning in an inconsistent way.
Maybe.
Maybe. And maybe in everywhere.
So, there is a lot of problems.
There are a lot of issues, but it's a good questions to think about. So it's a challenge for you to think if you think of some contribution of Bangladesh to the world. Next year in November, the 20th Asian Bioethics Conference will be held in Bangladesh in November. So in Dhaka. So Manuel, this may be a way for you to save up and come to Dhaka and then see what is Bangladeshi. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, most welcome.